Okay, good morning students. Let us continue with our previous class where we were studying about Plasmopara viticola. As you all know, this is one of a fungal pathogen which cause a disease called as downy mildew disease in case of grapes. So we were studying the about the pathogen, what are parasites, what are the different types of parasites, and we were studying in detail about Plasmopara viticola. So now let us study in detail about that. And also in my previous class, I had elaborated with mildews, the different types of mildews. You know, mildews are the appearance of the fungal pathogen on the surface of the infected part of the plant, where you could find the cottony mycelium or a powdery spores which has been accumulated on the surface of the infected part of the plants. The color of these mildews may vary from white, brown or purplish color, which you can find on the infected part of the plants. And also this particular disease is one of airborne disease. Mildews are airborne. Students, I have also explained what are airborne disease, soil-borne disease, seed-borne disease. Airborne is nothing but if the infecting pathogen is being found in the air, the dissemination or the transmission of the disease is through air, then it is called as airborne disease. If it is being found in a soil, then it is called as soil-borne disease. If the infecting pathogen, if it is found in seed itself, the farmer which where they are using seed for sowing, if such seed has been infected, then such seed, if it has been used and once that seed germinate and grow into a plant, the disease can happen. So such disease is called as seed-borne disease. However, the mildews are airborne disease. And also we studied in detail about downy mildew and powdery mildew. To brush up, downy mildew, where you can find the visible pathogen, where you can find the visible pathogen on the lower surface of the host, I mean especially on the leaves, where you can find them at the lower surface of the leaf. One second, students. At the lower surface of the leaf, you can find the cottony mass of mycelium containing sporangiophore and the sporangia at the lower surface of the leaf. Hence, it is called as downy mildew. In case of powdery mildew, you can find the conidiospore or the powdery mildew. The name, the symptom is called as powdery mildew because the powdery appearance of the fungal pathogen, which can be in the form of conidiospores on the surface. It can be both on the upper as well as at the lower surface of the leaf. You can find the infecting pathogen. Hence, it is called as powdery mildew. Another important difference is such kind of chlorosis. I had explained in my previous class also, the presence of chlorotic lesions on the surface of the leaf can be observed in the downy mildew, because the downy mildew causing pathogen, that is Plasmopara viticola, where it is one of an internal parasite, that is intracellular parasite, whereas in case of powdery mildew, such kind of chlorotic lesion is not found because that is one of a ectoparasite, whereas downy mildew is an endoparasite where it can enter even inside the host tissue and disturb the cells and the tissue, which leads to the chlorosis. That is the major difference between the downy mildew, symptoms of the downy mildew and the powdery mildew. And the downy mildew disease causing organisms, most of them belongs to the subdivision Mastigomycotina, whereas powdery mildew disease causing organisms, they belongs to Ascomycetes fungi. So this is the difference between the downy mildew and the powdery mildew disease. Now, and also we were discussing about the different types of pathogen which we could observe which causes downy mildew disease. The list which I have elaborated here are the dominant group of organism. Most of these, all these organisms belongs to the subdivision Mastigomycotina. So these are some of the pathogen which causes downy mildew in most of the economically important plant. And the type study which we are studying according to your syllabus is what? Plasmopara viticola, which causes downy mildew in case of grapes. So you have to remember these pathogens. This is for the point of your competitive examination I'm talking about. For your university examination, if you are very much enthusiastic only for university examination, this Plasmopara, which according to your syllabus you have to study, which causes downy mildew in grapes. The species is Plasmopara viticola. So now let us study about this Plasmopara viticola in detail. Coming to the pathogen called as Plasmopara viticola, this is one of a fungi which, as I had mentioned before also, which causes downy mildews in case of grapes. It causes downy mildew in case of grapes, and it belongs to the division Eumycota, subdivision, and also I had explained each and everything why it is belonging to Eumycota, because they are true fungi. Subdivision Mastigomycotina. Mastigo means hair-like structure, flagellated spores can be observed in this group. Mastigomycotina, oomycetes. This is the distinguishing characteristic feature of the oomycetes, is the formation of oospore, the formation of the flagella. Flagella in case of zoospore, where it is lateral, that I will show you what actually these zoospores and how it is lateral, that you have to remember. There are three important characteristic feature of, major characteristic feature of oomycetes. One is they produce a dormant spore called as, remember, oospore. That is the characteristic feature of oomycetes. If you come across zygomycetes, zygospore. Ascomycetes, ascospores. Basidiomycetes, basidiospores. Based on the type of spores produced, the sexual spores they produce, they have been placed. So this Plasmopara viticola has an ability of producing a spore called as oospore. Hence, it has been placed under oomycetes. Apart from that, another important characteristic feature of oomycetes fungi, always I'll be telling about this, they have a cell wall content of cellulose, is one of a polysaccharide which you can come across in oomycetes. That is very much important that you have to note down. And another important characteristic feature of this oomycetes is the formation of zoospores. Zoospores, where this zoospores produces a flagella at its lateral position. The zoospores have got the flagella. Zoospores means the motile spores are called as zoospores. If they have single flagella, it is called as uniflagellated. If they have two flagella, then it is called as biflagellated. And the position of the flagella is also important in order to delimit them into different classes. If they have been, the position of the flagella can be anterior or posterior or lateral. In case of oomycetes, the position of this flagella on the zoospore is lateral. That is important characteristic feature. And also the shape of the zoospore, it is bean shaped or kidney shaped zoospores can be observed in case of oomycetes. And this Plasmopara belongs to the order Perennosporales family, Perennosporaceae. And the genus of our interest, what we are studying in this particular class, is Plasmopara. The species is Viticola. So now let us study about the distribution of this particular pathogen. Wherever the grape has been grown worldwide, it has been one of the pathogen can infect the grape. It's worldwide in distribution. And however, it is the disease which is a native of North America, and later it has been reported in almost all the parts of the world. Even in India, we can find them extensively. Next, in my last class, we had left out over here. So now, let us study about the disease symptom of this particular disease. As I was mentioning, this is one of a pathogen which require a medium of water for the process of dissemination. Medium of water is required for the process of dissemination because the infecting propagule can be a zoospore. Zoospore, you know, they are flagellated, they are motile. For their motility, a medium of water is required. So the environmental condition required for the spread of disease is monsoon season. Students, kindly remember, monsoon is one of the best season for the spread of the disease. Early morning dewdrops, cool night, as well as the temperature ranging from 16 to 22 degrees Celsius favors the spread of the disease. and even early morning dew drops containing water, because they have water droplet in them. So the medium of water is required, and also they can get disseminated from the infected plant to the healthy plant through rain or through the breeze, through the wind. Even this droplets which are there on the infected plant, even they can get disseminated from healthy plant to from a infected plant to that of a healthy plant. Now, so this is about the environmental condition required. And also the spread of the disease can also happen if the field, the plantation, that particular field, if it has been not properly maintained, if proper sanitary measures, if it has been not followed. The sanitary measures, in the sense, if the previous season, in the previous season, wherever the farmers would have grown this grape plant, if it would have infected, if the same debris is being remained in that particular soil, the chances of infection in next season can also happen. That is the reason the field has to be kept clean, proper sanitary measures has to be followed in order to avoid the spread of the disease. So now let us study about the disease symptom. When you can call that this particular plant has been infected by Plasmopara viticola, and this particular disease is a downy mildew disease. So now, as I was mentioning, the transmission can happen through wind or through rain. So the infection usually happens to the aerial part of the plant. It can happen onto the stem or onto the leaf or onto the fruits or onto the tendrils or onto the buds or any aerial part of the plant, the infection can happen. And initial symptoms can be found on the leaves. On the leaves, you can find the initial symptom. What kind of symptom we can observe? Initially, we can see such kind of chlorotic lesions, chlorosis, the loss of chlorophyll pigment happened wherever the infection has happened. Wherever the infection has happened, there will be a chlorotic lesion, because that particular cell or that particular tissue has been disturbed. It would have been disturbed by this particular pathogen. It would have utilize the entire nutrition, and due to the utility of the entire nutrition, that particular cell or that particular tissue would have been destructed, which leads to the chlorosis. The chlorophyll pigment has been lost. That is an initial symptom which you can find, that chlorosis happen on the upper surface of the leaf. At the lower surface of the leaf, what you can find? You can find the cottony mycelial mat. Wherever there is a chlorotic lesion here and there, at its lower surface of the leaf, you can find what? The cottony mycelium, which would have emerged out of the host. That particular cottony mycelia, if you take one hand lens, or if you take out, you can tease out that particular the mycelia from that infected plant, and if you can observe it under the microscope, we can see the sporangia as well as the sporangiophore can be seen. That indicates, and another important characteristic feature of this particular pathogen is the sporangia is lemon shaped. Students kindly remember, it is lemon shaped sporangia can be observed. That is the characteristic feature of this Plasmopara. First symptom is, please make a note, points, you can make chlorosis on the infected leaves. Where? Chlorosis at the upper surface of the leaf. If you see the dorsal surface or the lower surface of the leaf, you can see the accumulation of cottony white brownish mycelium. And if you take out that particular mycelium, and if it has been observed under the microscope, what you can find? Sporangia, and the sporangiophore can be observed. The shape of the sporangia is lemon shape. And as the temperature increases, if the temperature is little more, what happens to this dead tissue, the chlorotic tissues whichever has been formed? They undergo a process of drying. If they dry, you can find such kind of brownish necrosis. That is, the drying of the leaf happens. The drying of the leaf is happening. As the infection proceeds, the entire leaf can become brown, and they can just droop down. they can just droop down and they can just fall down. So this is the symptom what you can find on the leaf. If the infection has happened onto the stem, if an infection has happened, you can find the swelling of the stem here and there. That is also one of the important symptom of this particular disease. Another major symptom is on the economically important part of the plant. The economically important part of the plant is our berries, that is the fruits. Fruits are the economically important part of the plant. So how actually the symptoms you can find on this. So here, the inflorescence, see what is inflorescence? This is the inflorescence. Inflorescence is nothing but the cluster of flowers are called as inflorescence, where actually this is the peduncle, the central axis of an inflorescence. The central axis of an inflorescence can get infected, and also the berries, the fruits. See, you can see the infected fruits in this particular image. In this particular images, you can find the fruits. What actually you can find? What's the difference between the normal one and the infected one? The infected ones, they turn brown. They turn brown as though they are rotting up. And also, the texture will be quite leathery, and also the juicy content in that particular infected fruits will be comparatively very less. As the infection proceeds, the entire fruits, entire berries, whatever has been formed, it would have been accumulated with that of a white mycelium. Mycelium would have accumulated on its surface. As this mycelium may enter into the reproductive phase, that is the reason it would have accumulated on the entire surface of the fruit. And also the older fruits also gets infected. If they are not getting infected also, obviously the peduncle or the stalk of the fruit would have been infected. Because of this particular reason, the fruit may just fall down. So these are some of the disease symptoms. First symptom is chlorosis, then the formation of the mycelium at the lower surface of the leaf, browning of the leaf, wilting of the leaf, falling of the leaf, the swelling of the stem, infection onto the tendrils, infection onto the fruits. The fruit is characterized, infected fruits is characterized by the change in the color to brownish, leathery texture, accumulation of the mycelium, less juicy content. These are some of the disease symptoms of downy mildew. Why it is downy mildew? Because the formation of cottony mycelium on the lower surface of the leaf. Hence, it is called as downy mildew. Is that clear? Now, let us proceed to the disease cycle. So if the question is being asked for 10 marks, 10 marker question, if it is, disease cycle has to be mentioned. If it is just a 5 marker question, need not have to elaborate the life cycle. You can talk about the systematic position, distribution, environmental condition, symptoms, and control measures. If it is 10 marker question, the disease cycle has to be elaborated. So now let us study how actually this Plasmopara viticola reproduce and how actually it infects the plants in detail. So if this plasma, as I was mentioning, the primary source of infection to the healthy plant is zoospores. It is zoospores. Zoospores are the one which causes primary infection to that of a healthy plant. Now let us study how actually these zoospores have been formed. So initially, once from the infected plant, if the plant has been infected, any grape plant has been infected with a downy mildew disease, that particular Plasmopara viticola undergoes a process of sexual reproduction, where they have an ability of producing the gametantia. They produces male and female gametantia. The male gametantia is called as antheridium. Male gametantia is called as antheridium, and the female gametantia is called as oogonium. Oogonium antheridium produces male and female gametes respectively. These two gametantia undergoes a process of fusion. They undergoes a process of fertilization, that is cytogamy. I think you know cytogamy, fusion of cytoplasm, followed by karyogamy, fusion of the nucleus, that is fusion of gametes happen to form a diploid oospore. this diploid zoospore, oospore, is a resting spore. It's a resting spore. That is, they accumulate thick wall around them so that it can withstand any unfavorable condition. Okay, so once this oospore has been formed on such infected plant, you can see the formation. This particular oospore would have been formed inside the host tissue. Inside the host, see, for example, if you consider this as an infected leaf, if you take a transverse section of this infected leaves and if you observe it under the microscope, you can see the formation of such kind of thick walled spores called as oospores. So such oospore formation happened due to the fusion of the gametes which are present in a oogonium and anthridium respectively to form a dormant oospore. If such infected leaves, if it is being found in debris, if it is found in the debris, infected leaves, which is, if it has been not cleaned properly by a planter. So what happened in next season, during unfavorable condition, that is during monsoon season, this would have happened. The oospore remain in that particular infected leaf or infected plant tissue and it is there in the soil. Onset of favorable condition in the sense monsoon season is a favorable condition for the germination of this oospore. This oospore germinate when? During favorable condition. What's the favorable condition? Monsoon. The temperature ranging from 16 to 22 degrees Celsius is a favorable season for this particular germination of this oospore. Oospore germinate and produces sporangia at its terminal region. This sporangia, inside the sporangia, the nucleus, which diploid nucleus, which is present in this sporangia, undergoes meiotic division, followed by very mitotic division. Later, this sporangium produces many zoospores. It produces many haploid zoospores. Once this zoospore has been formed, if that particular zoospore, once it come in contact in any way, either through a rain or a wind or through water or through equipment used by the farmer, anyhow, once it comes in contact with that of a healthy leaf, a healthy plant, what happens? This zoospore, which is having two flagella, biflagellated they are, and the position of the flagella is lateral. This is anterior position, this is posterior position, this is lateral position, and it has got two flagella. That is an important characteristic feature of oomycetes, as I was talking to. This zoospore, before infection, remember, students kindly remember, before infection, once it land on the host plant, they undergo a process of encystment. What is this encystment? They withdraw its flagella. The flagella has been withdrawn and they become encysted. Such encysted zoospore, once it come in contact with either onto the leaf or onto the fruit or onto the twig or onto the tendril, any part of the plant, it infects that particular host tissue. It can enter inside the host tissue and they grow intercellular. What is the meaning of this intercellular? Intercellular, that is in between two cells. See, this is the transverse section of the host. See, if you take a transverse section of the host and if you observe it under the microscope, this is how it looks. These are the host cells, green one are the host cells. And this brown one, which has been represented, these are the mycelium. And how is this mycelium? It is in between the cells, hence it is called as intercellular. If it enters inside the cell, such mycelium is called as intracellular mycelium. This is what kind of mycelium? This is intercellular mycelium. And how actually it utilize the nutrition, how actually it absorbs the nutrition. This intercellular mycelium produces haustorium. They produces not like haustorium. Here the type of haustorium, even the shape of the haustorium also matters in classification of different fungi. So here Plasmapara produces haustorium, which is knob-like structures or knot-like structures. So such kind of haustorium is projected inside what? Inside the host cell. And they try to absorb the nutrition from the host cell. At that particular moment, what is happening? The cell is losing all its nutrition and it is undergoing a process of death. Due to this symptom, what you can find on the infected leaf? Chlorosis can be observed. Once it utilizes all the nutrition from the host, this particular Plasmapara, they have to undergo a process of reproduction. So for the process of reproduction, they produces conidiophores. At that particular time, the symptoms can be like this. The infected leaves, at its lower surface, you can find the cottony mass. Why this cottony mass has been formed? This is due to the formation of this kind of sporangiophores. And also the grape fruits have been infected. And also the tendrils, the twig. See the twig, if you see the stem, you can see the swollen structure. This is also due to the infection by this particular pathogen. So once they enter into the reproductive phase, what happened? Once they enter into the reproductive phase, this particular Plasmopara produces various sporangiophores. They produces, sporangiophore, P-H-O-R-E, sporangiophore. This is a structure which produces sporangia. What are sporangiophores? These are the structures which produces their reproductive hyphae, which helps in the formation of sporangia. So once this particular Plasmopara enters into the reproductive phase, through stomata, see what are these stomata? These are the natural openings which helps in the process of respiration in case of plants. Where the number of stomata is more, usually at the lower epidermis of the leaf. You can see the number of stomata is more at the lower surface of the leaf. Through this stomata, the reproductive hyphae called as sporangiophore emerges out, either from a leaf or from the stem or from the fruit, whichever the part it is. The reproductive hyphae called as sporangiophore emerges out. These sporangiophore undergoes a process of branching. At the terminal region of these branches, you can find the formation of the sporangia. The shape of the sporangia is what? Lemon-shaped sporangia you can find at the terminal region of such kind of sporangiophores. These sporangia, lemon-shaped sporangia, this is a beak-like projection called as papillae. So such kind of sporangia, the nucleus inside the sporangia undergoes many mitotic division. The nucleus undergoes many mitotic division and leads to the formation of zoospores. Even the sporangia can become a zoosporangium and they have an ability of producing a zoospores. These zoospores, once they come in contact with the healthy plant, they undergo a process of encystment and can also infect the plant and the cycle can continue. And at the same time, if the infected leaf has been left out in that particular plantation, the infected leaf or a twig or whichever, the remnants, if it is present in the soil, even if they don't have oospore, even the mycelium, the dormant dried mycelium, which is there in that infected debris, even they, onset of favorable condition, even they can germinate, even they become active, and also they have an ability of producing such kind of sporangium, and such sporangium can produce a zoospore, and the cycle can continue. So this is about the disease cycle of Plasmopara viticola. And this, to make you all easy, I have drawn this and I have given a diagrammatic representation. This is what you have to write in your examination. So this, anyhow, I am sharing this particular video as well as the PPT. You can refer this, same, whatever I had explained, simplified diagrammatic representation I have given. Now, how to manage this particular disease? How to control this particular disease? Regular quarantine measures helps in preventing this introduction of this particular pathogen into the disease-free area. Always the disease-free area, if you have noticed, better to avoid this particular pathogen in any way. Quarantine measures has to be followed. Use of proper sanitary measures, that is keeping the plantation clean. If you find any infected plant, what you can do, you can just prune them. You can just prune them, and if there are fallen leaves or twigs or any such infected parts of the plants, if it is there, you can just take it out, pick it out, and it can be burnt into ashes. That is important sanitary measures which we have to follow. And use of disease resistant varieties, always prevention is better than cure. If you are using any disease resistant varieties have been also been reduced. Say for example, we have Amber Queen, Champa, Champion, Red Sultana. These are some of the disease resistant varieties which has been already produced, and it can be used by the farmer so that the chances of the spread of the disease to such kind of resistant varieties can be avoided. So better to go for disease resistant varieties. And another important thing is use of proper fungicide. Proper fungicide. What is the meaning of fungicide? These are certain chemicals which are used to kill the fungi. They are called as fungicide. One of an important fungicide is called as Borax mixture. Students, kindly remember for the point of your examination, Borax mixture. This is nothing but the composition is copper sulfate, calcium hydroxide and water in the ratio 4:4:50. What are the composition? Calcium hydroxide, copper sulfate and water in the ratio 4:4:50. This was discovered by Millardant from Bordeaux University. This is very much important for your competitive examination. And other important fungicides can also be, they have a broad spectrum of activities. Say for example, Mancozeb, Metalax, Manib, Zinib, Metriram. These are some of the fungicides. These are systemic fungicides. What's the meaning of systemic fungicides? These are the fungicides which can enter even inside the host tissue. Host tissue they can enter, whereas Bordeaux mixture is not a systemic fungicide. This is just we are going to spray it onto the surface. They can't penetrate inside the host tissue. So however, there are certain systemic fungicide, trade name Captan. This is one of a systemic fungicide which has been extensively used to control this downy mildew disease. When you have to spray this particular fungicide before blossom, before onset of flowering, and also at the intervals of 7 to 10 days of intervals, and also you have to see to that the rainfall and the growing season. Based on that, better to use this particular fungicide. Better to avoid such kind of systemic fungicide if we are using this particular grapes. If we are using this grapes for the process of wine production, because you know for the process of wine production we are using yeast, isn't it? Yeast is being used. So the chances of destroying this yeast can also happen because this is a systemic fungicide. Usually, if you are using this particular grape for wine production, they avoid all the systemic fungicide, that is Mancozeb, all this they are avoiding. So better to go for Bordeaux mixture, better to go for resistant varieties. Always keep the plantation clean with proper sanitary measures, and proper quarantine measures has to be followed to control this particular disease. So these are some of the reference book which you can use to study this particular topic. Better to go for PD Sharma, Agrios, Meherotra, and the websites which I have given in this particular PPTs. I think I am going to share this particular PPT also, students, so that it is easy for you all to understand. And also I am going to share the video which I have elaborated in this particular class. Students, any doubts if you have? Is it okay?